Yes, I can.
I have been told that a short while ago, not only this, the Pakistan's ex-information minister, PMLN leader, Mariam Aurangzeb, had actually blamed and accused you of being only playing in the hands of the Imran Khan government, but shortly I have been told that the ex-chief minister, Shahbaz Sharif, has himself said that he's going to file a case against you and against the Daily Mail. What is your response to that?
Well, my response is, let's see what he does. I have written an article which is based on many interviews and documentary evidence, and it also tries to give space to his family to respond to the allegations, and of course they deny this. I should say that when his brother was the subject of an article I wrote last year, Penthouse Pirate, about the property empire that Nawaz's family assembled in London, he said he was going to sue. And he didn't. And of course, what actually happened is he was convicted in court and is now in prison. So I think if Mr. Shahbaz Sharif says he wants to sue, that of course is his privilege, and we will defend it.
Very interesting. So thanks for reminding us that even Nawaz Sharif had threatened legal action against you and Daily Mail, but he didn't subsequently. But the PMLN leadership over here and Shahbaz Sharif family is making a huge capital out of the fact that the Department for International Development, the UK aid itself, has basically said that they have monitored and scrutinized and they're satisfied that none of the DFID money has gone into the wrong hands. Whereas your story says that some of the funds, at least some of the funds that were money that were laundered from across Pakistan to UK and back, actually came from the UK aid and DFID.
Well, let's look at the DFID statement. DFID, in their statement, say it's a rebuttal. It's not a rebuttal at all. What it actually is a repetition of the quote which they gave me last week, which I published in the story. They just repeat the same quote. That's what they told me then. Now, what they're saying is this. There is documentary evidence that money was taken from the earthquake fund. There is a court case in Pakistan in which Malik Naveed, who was the director of finance for the earthquake fund, has admitted that he stole more than £1.5 million and that some of this money was also given to Ali Imran, Shahbaz's son-in-law. Now, that's a matter of court record. So DFID is saying this. It's making a very strange argument. It is saying, yes, some money was taken from the earthquake fund. Yes, we gave that fund £54 million. But it wasn't our money that was taken. We're confident that our processes are robust. It wasn't our money. It was somebody else's money.
Okay.
This is very strange. Because if you look at the way that DFID spent that money, it didn't earmark the money. That's their word. A report on DFID, written at the time that fund was in operation, says there was a problem because the money that DFID sent was not earmarked but was put into the general budget. It also said there was a serious problem with accountability in the way that the fund was run. So DFID can now say, oh, yes, we're sure it's not our money. And I can say, well, really? You would say that, wouldn't you?
Of course. My last question to you is, I mean, in the end, in the last paragraph of your detailed story, very detailed story, I read it twice to fully understand it, you have mentioned a figure of approximately £21 million were basically used and laundered through this way. And then you said an additional £9 million might actually also be investigated. But then you quote a figure that a total of £160 million, which according to the rate of conversion would come to around Pakistani rupees 32 crore. How have you come to that conclusion, that magical figure of £160 million?
From two sources. One is documents. The second is which set out the details. And secondly, interviews. And I should tell you, I have not yet published all those interviews. Now, the thing is, the scheme that laundered £21 million, every payment paid under that method is listed and traced. And there are detailed bank records for each and every one. Now, those are using fake investors. There's a second class of payment involving ghost investors, people who didn't exist at all, who paid money using similar methods into the family's bank account. But then there's another, even bigger class of payments, which were basically fake loans. Certain individuals made loans to companies controlled by the family. But they weren't loans at all because they were never paid back. What they actually were was yet more foreign remittances, which were laundered money being paid to others, to third parties, who then gave that money to the family. There was never any question of paying that back. Now, I've actually interviewed one of those people. He will be an approving witness if this case comes to court. He has been responsible for colossal loans to paid to the family, much bigger than the amounts that involved this guy in Birmingham. Hmm. So all I can say is there's more to come here, and more detail will come out in due course.
Thank you, David Rose. Thank you so much, Nazreen. Breaks.